take another 3 minutes, finish up the bell work, and then we'll get going. Also, when I upload this to YouTube as my lesson, I'm definitely getting a copyright hit. It's a good thing I'm not monetizing my lessons. Jack and Guthrie waiting on you. Give us a quick answer. Doesn't have to be too complicated. I'm going to stop Dave Matthews there. If you have a, if you have guitar with buyers, let them know that I was playing some Dave Matthews. He'll be happy about that. Guthrie, finish up. Give us that answer.
I did.
Awesome. Sweet. Okay. So, right, we're going to do bell work. We're going to get into groups a little bit later, and then we are going to be coming back together at the end of class to discuss what we did in our groups and in class. Today's going to be pretty fast, depending on just the pace. So I'm going to read through our answers anonymously, and then I'd love to have a little bit of a discussion, either in the chat or through through voice. I would love if we unmuted ourselves a little bit today about, does science prove things to be true? When we have a finding, do we know that finding is true without any doubt? This is a controversial question, so I think it warrants some good discussion. All right, I'm going to read through some of our answers here. I think that science can prove things to be true, and I think that most of the time when we have a finding, we can know that it is true without any doubt. Okay, so yes and yes to both, and like strong answers. Science does prove things to be true most of the time. No, it takes time to see if something is true. So not necessarily right away, but maybe the doubt goes away over time. Yes, science proves things to be true, but we can't be sure anything is true until it is proven. Okay, this can be a long time. Science can prove things to be true if many findings agree with each other. So it needs to be, it needs to happen multiple times. Okay. However, when we have a finding, it isn't necessarily true. It could be a fluke. But if many others find the same thing, then it most likely isn't a fluke. Science does prove things to be true. Gravity is proven true because if it didn't exist, we would all float away. Okay. Well, maybe it's not gravity that's keeping us on the Earth. It's maybe like invisible ghosts grabbing our feet and holding us down, right? And just want anything to fly up. I don't know. Has anyone proven that the ghost grabbing feet idea isn't true? I don't know. Right? Maybe this is the new science. I believe it does prove things to be true, but we don't know without a doubt if it's true. Okay, so true, but sometimes there's still doubt. I'm catching on to a trend here. Science can prove things to be true, but if we find something about it, we have to do tests until we have no doubt that it is true. Not necessarily, says someone else, as we may not have known about a key factor that changes the finding significantly. No, science can't prove anything true, only predict and speculate why things happen. All right. We have a lot of similar answers, but there's some of us that says, in the end, there is no doubt. At some point, we have no doubt that this thing is true. And some of us say that, yes, we'll say it's true, but for now, maybe something changes. Or, you know, somewhere along the line, I'm not going to hold on to this with like the firmest grip, right? I'm gonna hold it, but if something changes, that it's going to change, okay? So first off, let's think about possible examples. What might be an example of something we held to be true and then changed because we got new evidence? Has that ever happened in the history of science? Science in particular, right? You can type into the chat. You can unmute yourself. What might be, and I'm going to stop the share for now so I can see all your faces. So what might be one thing that has changed? Atomic structure. Yeah. Has anyone, I think, oh, shoot. There's a funny name for it. It's like the pudding pie model or something. So we thought atoms used to be like, there was a bunch of goop essentially that kept all the protons and neutrons, electrons there, yeah. Right?
Plum pudding. It was plum pudding.
Plum pudding. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Cy. We once thought the Earth was flat. Do you guys know? Some of us still think that the Earth is flat, not us in this class, I hope. In which case, Elon Musk is gonna send you to space soon, I'm sure, and we'll get a great like teenagers react to the Earth not being flat video. Do you guys know who did it? Like how long ago? Can you guess maybe like the year? Galileo? Nope, Galileo didn't do it.
Is it like the 1500s though?
I can guess even earlier. Yeah. Earlier than the Protestant Reformation. Yeah, earlier than the Enlightenment. Elon Musk. Elon Musk discovered that the Earth isn't flat. Yep, that's actually it, guys. It was Elon Musk. He's been alive for several centuries. No, there is Archimedes. I don't think it was Archimedes. It was a Greek. I wasn't prepared for this. I forget his name exactly, but I remember this is a Greek in ancient times, 24 BC. Aaliyah's quickly typed in, unless it's off the top of her dome, which would be sweet. Okay, so who discovered the Earth is round? What's his name? Pythagoras? Was it Pythagoras? Yeah, it's actually Pythagoras. So what he did is he noticed that there was a well, I believe in Alexandria, that on the summer solstice, there was no shadow in this well. And then he traveled farther north and he noticed on the same day of the year, where right the sun should be in the same place, that there was actually a shadow cast on an obelisk. And so he noticed that the Earth was not flat, right? If the Earth was flat, then we should see no shadow in both places or a shadow in both places. But he saw on the same day there was no shadow and then there was a shadow. So something was weird. And so he was able to actually use the Pythagorean theorem to figure out the curvature of the Earth from those two places, using the mileage, figured out, I think to some like insanely accurate degree, the circumference of the Earth. Anyways, what about the solar system? Did we always think the solar system was the same? No. What do we think? What about the solar system?
Didn't like we think that everything else orbited around Earth?
Yeah. We call this geocentric. Okay, so this means geo is Earth for us. And then centric, right? In the center. So Earth is in the center. We thought everything went around the Earth, right? If I look up at the night sky, the sun goes around the Earth, guys. Like, have you not noticed this? The sun rises in the morning and then it sets in the evening. It goes around the Earth. Duh. Come on. But Venus consistently stays close to the sun. It either rises in the morning, so we called it the morning star, or it set in the evening with the sun, so we called it the evening star. So it's one of these two things. This is a little bit strange. We also see that like the planets would move across the night sky, but they would slow down, and then they would have what's called a retrograde motion. They would move back, and then they would move forward again. If it's going around the Earth, that seems a little bit strange. So we had this really complex idea of what a geocentric solar system looked like. Copernicus has come along and says, hey guys, it's way, way, way simpler if the Earth goes around the sun and all the other planets go around the sun. We discovered that dodos didn't look as stupid as we thought. Wait, do they look different than like instead of like a...
Yeah. It was in a National Geographic a couple months ago. Okay. They don't actually look that different. They're just a bit like less fat.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Like what? So that's science, right? We're changing things around. Yeah. Pluto was a planet once. This is interesting. So we thought that Pluto was like the other planets. And also America's like, this is our planet, gosh darn it. And I'm going to keep this planet. It is ours. You stinking Europeans, you figured out where all the smaller ones won, were like Neptune and Uranus. Pluto's ours, so we're going to keep it. But then we learned like, well, there's a lot of other like space junk out there with Pluto. Pluto's still a planet in my heart too. I love Pluto. And I don't think we have to demean it by calling it a dwarf planet. I think it's okay if it has a different classification. All right, I'm digressing here. We get more evidence about Pluto. We find out it's a little bit different than other planets. And we decide as a scientific community that actually we should probably call it something else because there's a lot of other things that are similar to Pluto that make it maybe a different classification. Okay. I've actually worked at Lowell Observatory and they encouraged me to like not care. They're like, yep, this is what the scientific community said. And I mean, straight from the people who discovered the planet, they said, it's okay. All right. I still love Pluto. Pluto's great. If you haven't seen the New Horizon video or pictures with Pluto with a heart on it, it's great. Have you guys not seen that? Anyways, I'll show you maybe at the end of class. All right. So what I want to point out here is that science is fluid. And for the most part, actually, science builds on itself. So with the solar system, we thought the Earth was in the center. And then we realized that this wasn't the case. Then we said, well, okay. Maybe the solar system is special. The solar system is at the center of the universe, right? It wasn't just that the Earth was at the center of the solar system. It was that the solar system or the Earth was the center of the universe. And we start to learn that actually, there are a lot of other solar systems and they are going around a galactic center. So we said, okay. Well, maybe our solar system isn't the most important, but maybe like the big city of the Earth that it lives in is important. So the galaxy is at our galaxy, the Milky Way is at the center. Well, there's a lot of other galaxies and they are all moving away from one another. And we come up with these two things that let us know that kind of no matter where you are in the solar system, everything's going to be in the universe, everything's going to be moving away from you and it's going to be accelerating away from you. So no place is necessarily special in terms of your placement. And so each time we kept learning about our universe, we found out that the Earth was not at the center of the solar system, not at the center of the galaxy, not like there wasn't a special star, there's not a special galaxy, and no matter where you are, the universe kind of looks the same. Okay, all right. So this is how science works. It grows, it builds on itself, right? We didn't throw away the whole thing. The solar system was still there. We just changed how it looked for ourselves. So what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be looking at our data from our labs. And I think that I returned that to you. I think I did. If not, I will do so. Yeah, I returned it to you. Or no. There we go. All right. Need to edit this. This is 20 points. All right. So what we're going to be doing is we are going to be discussing our data and figuring out what our different relationships are between the variables. Okay. So there are three kinds of relationships between the variables that are pretty simple that I'm going to go over with you guys. And they should be ones that we're relatively familiar with. But in case we've forgotten, right, it's been a long time since we've done some math, I would imagine that it would be helpful for us to go over this. Just a quick run over. If you've forgotten what these relationships are, please write them down, okay? All right. Also, I have a new pen for writing on my tablet, and I'm super excited. So, because it should make it a lot simpler to write. Okay, so going back to the Google Jamboard. Okay. So, let's erase this, or actually put a frame. All right. So the first relationship that we are going to be looking at is called no relationship. So let's draw our X and Y axes, X and Y, right? Does anyone remember what goes on the X axis? What goes here? The independent variable or the dependent variable?
The independent variable?
The dependent?
Independent.
Thank you, Guthrie. Sorry. Yes. So if we're dealing with the independent variable, you'll remember that that is the one you have control over, which is the one that you changed, right? If I can physically change the length of my string, that is the independent variable. Now we want to see what that changes. So that would be the dependent. So for all three of our graphs that we'll have, the dependent variable is going to be the period in terms of seconds, okay? And then the X variable is going to change based on what we're graphing. So I'll just leave it as X for now. All right. So if I have no relationship, this means that as I change my independent variable, the dependent variable doesn't change whatsoever, right? There's no relationship between the two. No matter what I do, I can't affect it. So it's just a flat line straight across. Okay, this is called no relationship. Okay. So if I change the mass, period, and length, and I don't see any change, mass, length, and angle, and I don't see a change in the period, that means there's no relationship. You will see at least one of these in our data collection today. All right. So that's no relationship. Now, if I have, starting at some point here, if I see my data increase, if I go along my x-axis, if I increase my X variable and my Y variable also increases, this is what we call a positive relationship. As the independent variable increases, so does the Y variable, so does the dependent variable. And then lastly, I'll leave relationship there for us. Lastly, if I see it go down the graph, right? As X increases, Y decreases. This is called a negative relationship. Negative, there we go. Negative relationship. Okay, so these are the three kinds that you're going to be looking at. I'm going to be putting you into small groups and breakout rooms, and then I'm going to be calling on some of us to explain which relationships there are for different graphs. Okay, I'll explain that in the breakout rooms when I get there. All right. Okay, so let's make these breakout rooms. All right. So the first variable that we changed was mass. Ash, would you explain the relationship between the two, and then we'll discuss if we all agree with your conclusion.
Well, the relationship between the two, the mass and the pendulum, was that, like, the mass would consistently change, but the time would stay the exact same.
So what kind of relationship do we call that? Is that a positive, negative, or no relationship?
No relationship.
Yeah, right. When the period doesn't change, right, mass doesn't affect it. So there's no relationship between the two. You can actually think about this as my relationship to somebody in the depth of Russia, right? If I go out and buy an orange from the grocery store, there is no relationship between that and how this person in the Russian wilderness lives, right? There's no relationship there. Okay, so that's how you can think about it, right? Mass doesn't affect how period works. Cool. Can I see a show of thumbs up if we agree that there is no relationship between mass and period? If you don't have your camera on, please use the thumbs up reaction. Sweet. Thank you, Aaliyah. I'm going to take that as pretty much a unanimous vote. So we have some scientific truth that we have agreed on, right? In science, what happens is we come together as the scientific community, right? This class is, in some sense, a microcosm of the larger scientific community, and we're all agreeing that this is true. We have come to the same conclusions. It is replicable, so this is true. Cool. All right. Next was length. Guthrie, would you explain the relationship between length and period of a pendulum?
An increase in the length of the pendulum will result in a increase in the time that it takes for it to complete a period, because with a longer pendulum, it has to travel a longer distance to create one period.
Awesome. And
it is a positive relationship.
Well said. You actually did more than I asked of you. You gave me a reason why it happens, right? I just wanted to know what the relationship was. At this point, we don't actually know if that's the case. We haven't actually done any physics to figure that out. But you're right. Because it has to travel a longer distance, it is going to take a longer time to do so. Cool. Who says, well, I kind of confirmed it, but we need to confirm this together. So let me see thumbs up if we have a positive relationship between length and period. Awesome. So one of the things as well is that the simulation gives us really, really clean data, right? If all our data is really clean, then it makes it easy to agree. Now, once we get back into the classroom, fingers crossed, right? We're gonna be dealing with the real world. There's gonna be a lot more variables that we'll have to consider, and some of these discussions will get more complex. So you'll have to be careful as you take your data. You're not gonna have the perfect timer, the perfect release of the pendulum, that sort of thing. Cool. So yes, we have a positive relationship between the length and the period. What about angle? Would Xavier explain to us the relationship between angle and period?
We all agreed that it's positive. Got it.
Cool. All right, so the group that Xavier's in said it was positive. Can I see thumbs up if you also found a positive relationship between period and or angle and period? All right, sweet. So we're in agreement. Now, is it as drastic of an increase? So if I doubled my angle, would I see the period increase by more? Right, or by a significant amount? Or is it tenths of a second? Is it hundredths of a second? How much does it increase? Is it a lot? Is it a little? Especially in with comparison to length. Length should be a very obvious positive relationship, but is angle just as obvious?
The difference from angle is in the tenths of a second for every 20 degree increment.
Okay. So we would see it be significantly slower if it was there. Okay, cool. All right. So we have no relationship, positive relationship, and positive relationship as well. These are our three relationships for our different variables. For homework tonight, you need to create your graphs. You can either do this on a sheet of paper. I do want you to write it out today because I need to know that you know all the different parts that you can produce that yourself. Programs make it really, really easy. They include all of those bits and pieces for you. So what I want you to do is I want you to draw it out. You can either use graph paper. You can use it on a line sheet of paper, as long as it's to scale. And then you can take a picture and load it into the Google Drive and then attach it to the Make Your Graphs assignment, okay? If you need help with doing that, I am available today. Just remember that my office hours are Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 2 to 3, and it's the same Zoom link. So if you ever need help, join this Zoom link, and then you'll find me, okay? But it's from 2 to 3, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. But if you need some help after class, I am available. Okay? With that said, that's all I have for class. We discussed their data. We came up with the relationships. It's all good. All right. Stick around at the end of class if you need some help. I will see you guys on Friday.